Well, good morning. It's Monday, the 21st of January, 2013, and we're preparing a venture based on my experience and development of a unique mathematical education channel on YouTube. I'll be giving some background about how we got to be where we are now. The Mathview Channel on YouTube now has posted more than 100 videos and has received more than 400,000 YouTube views worldwide. And the surprising thing to me is these mathematical videos that I've just been making here out of my home office in Palm Springs with just a lot of peace and solitude and time to contemplate and think about how to communicate mathematics. What I'm finding is that our videos are very highly rated according to Google PageRank for video search. So this is an objective criterion for how good your video is. How high is your PageRank? When one does searches using Google, my stuff is coming out in the top 10, sometimes multiple hits on the top 10, sometimes first ranked, and often outperforming videos from major academic powerhouses like Stanford, MIT, and it dawned on me that this is an objective victory for what I developed over the last 5 years. I've really been working on this since I left the academic world in 2005. I've really had time to think through, to contemplate, and look at the problem. Now, what makes it difficult for anyone to learn advanced mathematics, and what makes it easy? So, let me just say that over my career in academics and research, I had a undergraduate double major in physics and mathematics, graduated Phi Beta Kappa from University of Arizona, and was admitted to Cornell University Graduate School in physics, and there studied through the graduate division courses, and I completed my PhD thesis in 1979 and received my PhD in physics from Cornell. During these adventures in the academic world, I met and interacted with many brilliant, world-famous scientists, mathematicians, and engineers, and got to see these guys in action. But what I would say about this, in order to get in the door, you need to know the mathematical language which is used in physical theories. Let me just say that people love the Discovery Channel. They love seeing Carl Sagan's Cosmos series. By the way, I knew Carl Sagan when I was a grad student at Cornell. And people of all ages are fascinated by this stuff, bizarre phenomena like black holes, Higgs particle, string theory, and all of these mysterious subjects. And they are intellectually fascinating for everyone. If you're a motivated student or a curious adult and you want to learn more about this stuff, in the old days, we would perhaps go down to the library and check out a book, say a book on introductory quantum mechanics. You know, everyone in this room is literate. You can read. But if you pick up a book on a technical mathematical theory, the reading process is entirely different. And it's just about like having the text printed in ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs or something. So there's a barrier to entry. How do you get in the door? Now, if I go back to the problem that students have, beginning college students or undergraduate students, mathematics is taught in an unfriendly way, generally, and it's off-putting to many. Over my academic life, I've observed some important things, and I'm going to share those with you now. I have heard talks and met personally many really superstars of science, and they are different from what I expected. I expected them to be some kind of high priest, you know, talking in formal, religious tones. And what I found out is that the people who are really good, the Nobel Prize winners, they have a way of talking about their stuff that is remarkably simple, straightforward, and down to earth. it's sort of relentlessly honest. They don't tend, I mean, there are some exceptions, but these highly accomplished, world-famous physicists and mathematicians generally have a very clear vision of what they're talking about, and they communicate that when they're giving presentations and talking about their work. And that's all how I have always felt about understanding of advanced topics, advanced mathematics, is if you really understand it, it's really simple. Because the only way that you can get clear, conscious understanding of a, you know, abstract concept, abstract theory, abstract equation, is by breaking it down into simple, understandable, honest steps, pieces, conceptual pieces that make the whole thing work. Let me say something else. When I had some time to think back on my career and my experiences as a learning student, one of the things I wanted to do is share some kind of tricks of the trade and stuff that I learned by chance or by happening to be at the right place at the right time served well over many years. One example of this, our quantum mechanics teacher at Cornell was Hans Bethe. Hans Bethe, you may know, was head of the theory division of the Manhattan Project. He's a Nobel Prize winning physicist and sort of a Tolstoy or something, towering figure in modern physics, quantum mechanics, and a nuclear theory. Professor Bethe was a graduate student under Arnold Sommerfeld in Germany. Anyway, Professor Bethe was talking about this problem in quantum mechanics, and he said, we can reduce the problem to doing this integral. Professor Sommerfeld showed me how to do this integral, and now I'm going to show you how to do this integral. So, you know, we're handing down through a couple of generations of physicists how to do a mathematical calculation that is pivotal in our understanding and quantitative understanding of quantum mechanics. So, flash forward to 2005 or so, I thought, well, you know, I know a lot of kind of really important tricks that I acquired, insights, examples, stuff learned the hard way, where and how people make mistakes. And so I thought, well, since we have a way of communicating now, because of YouTube, we have a way of communicating that was not available to anybody in the past. We can talk about things and make visual records in a way that is entirely new in communications for every individual. Each individual has this power. So I thought, well, what a great idea. I'll just spend some time making a video or two that just sort of outlines some of the really useful insights and things that help me cut through the confusion of jargon and symbols and master the fear and uncertainty that students face when they are confronted or need to learn advanced mathematics. So that's kind of where I started. But one of the things I noticed is that the format of mathematical presentations on YouTube and generally in videos is rather unsatisfactory. And so I spent quite a bit of time, several years, developing a video presentation format that I felt was superior to what was being used at the time. And I believe it is still probably the best format for video presentation of mathematics around. There are other channels on YouTube that do stuff that's somewhat similar, but as I mentioned at the beginning, our stuff is video search ranked in the top 10, often number one, often in the top two or three. So we're doing something right. Now, of course, on YouTube, a kitten playing with string can generate a million views, but for advanced mathematics, so we're going to be talking about advanced mathematics. This is mathematics that includes calculus, real analysis, and topics that are usually taught in the junior and senior years, maybe in graduate school, sometimes to younger students as well. So we're going to talk about advanced mathematics. And so the universe of search terms, universe of terms that's used to describe what we're dealing with, are rather specialized. So, you know, we're going to talk about Google searches for videos on topics like tensor analysis and the covariant derivative, topological spaces, Riemann manifolds, and so on. So these are sort of technical terms. I think most people have heard about these things. So within that universe of search, those videos that purport and otherwise tag themselves with these standard mathematical terms, that's the universe of search terms that we're going to be talking about when we get down to objective evaluation of how good our channel is, how good our format, and how good our material is compared to everybody else in the world. Okay, so let's stop right now. Please stay tuned for part two of this overview and walkthrough of the Mathview channel on YouTube. Hi all. Well, today we're going to talk about the abstract concept of a function, and we're going to lead up to how you define the continuity of functions, differentiability, and the role of topology plays in all those definitions and properties. But what is a function anyway? Well, suppose you have two sets, and we're going to keep this sort of abstract at the beginning. And let's say typical elements of the set A, we'll call X is an element of A and Y is an element of B. A function is a rule which associates each element X of A with one and only one element Y of B. This is written, probably seen this, and usually F of X equals Y. And since F is acting on the elements in A, this is sometimes described, F is mapping the set A to the set B. This is pretty abstract. Usually we're interested in sets which have some mathematical structure, for instance the real numbers or topological space. An important question becomes when you're defining functions between sets that have some mathematical structure to them is does the action of F preserve the properties of the mathematics? For example, does the function F preserve the mathematical structure when it transports elements of A over into the set B? Generally, functions that preserve some mathematical structure are called morphisms. So for instance, if A is a topological space and the action of F preserves the topology on B, then that function is called a homeomorphism. If you're dealing with the real numbers and mappings, say real functions, functions that map the real numbers to real numbers, this rule is usually stated in terms of a formula. You know, you need some kind of a prescription, some kind of recipe that defines F. So the function F is said to map the set A to the set B. So there's a sort of an action called sometimes called the action of F on the set A. And this arrow means it's mapping A to B. So for instance, if the function F is a mapping on the real numbers, say F maps R to more real numbers over here, R, it can be defined by a formula because you have an algebraic field of elements of R. So you can calculate a new element X squared, or you can add two elements together, or you can add an element B, add a number B to X, or multiply it by a specified number, and get these various functions
that make use of the algebra of the real numbers. Now, the rule, the definition of F, may not work for all the elements of the set A. It may be restricted to a set D contained in A. So the set of elements, the subset of elements of A on which F is defined is called the domain of F. And it's also sometimes called the domain of definition. And in the domain, every element of the set D has a value defined by F. The domain of definition, or the domain, can also be arbitrarily specified. For instance, you may want to look at a function that is only defined on a open interval A to B. And so you can restrict the domain of definition arbitrarily in the definition of F. If there is an element of A that is not in the domain of definition, say Q is an element of A, but F of Q is undefined, we can say that F of Q, you might say, equal to the empty set. If the set C is contained in the domain of F, then we can consider a many-to-many mapping, where you take the entire set C, and all the elements in C have values defined by F, because C is in the domain of F. This is equal to some subset of the set B, F mapping A to B. Here's another term. The image of C is this C caret over here in B. So this is the image of the set C under F. So the mapping F is said to map the set C to its image in B. What's the range of the function F? So if you have the domain of definition of F, and you evaluate F for every element of the domain of definition, that is equal to the range of F. So the range is the image of the domain of definition. And so what that means is that every element in the range of F is equal to the value of F for some element in the domain of F. Okay.